بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين خاتم النبيين محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم اللهم صل والصلاة والسلام على أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين ولعن الله على أعدائهم أجمعين بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم السلام علیکم ورحمۃ اللہ وبرکاتہ قال اللہ سبحانہ وتعالی فی کتابہ المجید وفرقان الحمید بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم وذرنی والمکذبین اولی النعمۃ ومہلہم قلیلا انا لدینا انکالا وجحیما وطعاما ذا غصبۃ وعذابا علیما یوم ترجف العرض والجبال وکانت الجبال کثیبا محیلا انا ارسلنا الیکم رسولا شاہدا علیکم کما ارسلنا الی فرعون رسولا فعسا فرعون الرسول فاخذناه اخذا وبیلا فکیف تتقون ان کفرتم یوم یجعل الولدان شیبا السماء منفطر به کان وعده مفعولا ان هذه تذکرة فمن شاء اتخذ الى ربه سبیلا آمنا بالله وصدق الله العلی العظیم Our discussions have been on Surah Muzzammil. We now go on to the third section, which is ayah number 11 to 19, in which Allah says, and I will read the translation before we go into the first ayah of this section for Tafseer. It says, and leave me alone. Allah says, leave me alone and the rejectors, the possessors of ease, plenty, and respite them a little. Surely with us are heavy fetters and a flaming fire, and food that chokes a painful punishment. On the day when the earth and the mountains shall quake and mountains shall become heaps of sand let loose. Surely we have sent to you a messenger, a witness against you, just as we sent a messenger to Fir'aun. But Fir'aun disobeyed the messenger, so we laid on him a violent hold. How then will you guard yourselves if you disbelieve on the day which shall make even children grey-headed? The sky shall rend asunder thereby. His promise is ever brought to fulfillment. Surely this is a reminder, then let him who will take the way to his Lord. In Surah Muzzammil, we have discussed and we have spoken about this, that the main issue is when Rasulullah is told to rise and take up a great responsibility of delivering the message of Allah. But this responsibility is such that it needs self-building and a spiritual heart, in which the night worship has been emphasized, the program of self-building has been said in the other ayahs of the Quran, by which and through which Quran itself is one that strengthens faith, one's resolve, taqwa, and training of the soul, and that the Quran should not be considered as any other book, just reading like a storybook or anything. It has its own ways of doing and reciting the Quran, of implementing what Allah's messages are in our life and our effort towards that. In the first section of this surah, we saw that Allah has required and discussed the basic requirements of self-building. In the second section, we discussed that Allah is inviting Rasulullah towards patience, to observe patience and perseverance in the face of the enemies, because that is also an extremely important part in that, at that juncture of Rasulullah. However, like all ulamas tell us, that these things, although are addressed to Rasulullah, is not exclusive for Rasulullah, but a lesson for us as well, so that we may implement those lessons from the Quran and implement them in our lives. The 10th verse that we discussed last time is an allusion to the enemies of Islam. Who are the enemies of the Islam? who were simply obstructive to the message as well as the messenger, and speaking injuriously towards Rasulullah, and annoying and harassing Rasulullah by their words. And we can see them even today, that if 14 centuries later, if we have Muslims who are changing and twisting the teachings of Rasulullah, is the same annoyance. The annoyance and harassing can be considered in the same way. What jahalat and ignorance must have existed 14 centuries ago, if today this is the situation in modern times, where people's outlook is so different than what must have been at that time. And Allah tells His Messenger that it is He who will deal with them and punish them. It is not our job, it is His job, Allah says. We'll punish them both in this world as well as the hereafter. And Allah, in His infinite mercy, has also invited these evildoers. Come, change yourselves. Come and take a lesson from Rasulullah. He is my messenger. And come and have a change of heart and abandon your evil plans against Rasulullah. Because by being against Rasulullah, you are not only against the message, the messenger, but you are also against the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Rasulullah, as we know, has not spoken one word unless he got the wahi of Allah. So that is a very important aspect that we must have in our minds. The verses that follow also give consolation to Muslims. Allama explains that this is a consolation to Muslims, that although you may be few, and because of the declaration of the message by Rasulullah, you may be few followers, yet it is a consolation from Allah that don't worry about the enemies. You do your job and what you are supposed to do and present the message accordingly, because it is my message and therefore I will give you the protection and I will deal with the enemies of the message. It is my job, it is my message, so I will deal with those who oppose it. Now, this first verse of the third section says, وَزَرْنِي وَالْمُكَذِّبِينَ أُولِي النِّعْمَةِ وَمَحِلْهُمْ قَلِيلًا. Allah says that this enmity that is against the message, the messenger, is actually against the message, and therefore it is against Allah Himself. And He says, and leave me, therefore, that is Allah saying, Allah says, leave me with the rejectors. I will deal with them, the possessors of ease and plenty, and respite them a little. Leave them for a while, and you will see the result very soon. If we look at history, we will see that Janab Zainab Ulya Maqam Salawatullahi Wasalamu Alaiha has also told Yazid that Allah has given you a little respite. Don't think as you are free from doing whatever you like. And this is something that was consistent with all the Ahlul-bayt alayhimus salam, that Allah Himself has said, give them a little respite. They will come back, or they will have enhanced their own sins. So, here again, Allama emphasizes that the emphasis is that because the message is Allah's, therefore Allah Himself will deal with those who oppose the messenger. At the same time, Allah is asking Rasulullah that there is need for him to leave the enemies a little loose. Leave them, they will one day realize and come back towards what is right. Or if they don't, then I know how to deal them, Allah says in that manner. And then He says, this will be the reason for you. When you do that, you deliver the message. And we all know that Rasulullah's responsibility is only to deliver the message. Allah is telling him that you deliver the message, and that will be a hujjah, a proof upon those who receive the message. And therefore, it will allow you to have completed, it will give you a reason to have completed your responsibility, and allow you to prove to all that this is the true faith. Because when you are delivering the message, you will see that people will realize that this is a true message. It is the truth. There is nothing wrong in this message, and therefore you will also prove that you are also a true messenger of Allah with that. And thus these enemies are given a chance to show their true colors. Either you get a change of heart. Now we all know as we grow, we all change for the better. And we get better with our aqaid, and we get better with our actions and deeds. The better our aqaid is, the better we understand and get our taqwa, the better our deeds are going to become. And this is a total process. This is not only for everyone else, but it is including ourselves on how we should improve ourselves also. However, here the warning is for the enemies of Rasulullah and the enemies of Quran and the enemies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah then says, when the time will arrive, my punishment, that is Allah's punishment, will overcome them and squeeze their throats. Here Allama is explaining the historical situation of what happens in that early stage. He says that initially Muslims were harassed and persecuted. We know in Makkah the way Bilal, for example, or Ammar Yasir and his parents were harassed and actually persecuted by the Quraysh. They were beaten up. They were, and all that happened that we all know is part of history. In a very short period of time, Muslims gave back a lethal blow to these enemies. And we see that Muslims overpowered these enemies very, very quickly in the battles of Badr, Uhud, Hunain, Ahzab, and these are the battles that have been named. And it says, Imam says, look at the battle of Badr, for example. It has happened in the second year of Hijrah. And within 15 years of Bihasat, Rasulullah gave his message for 13 years in Makkah, and within the second year after Hijrah to Medina, that is 2 years, within the first 2 years, there was a battle of Badr that took place. And that we see that 15-year period is a very small and a very short period of time that Muslims did come and were victorious over the enemies. And subsequently, he says that these proud enemies, the very proud enemies, were overtaken one after the other. Allah did not leave even one of them. He took them one after the other, who left this world in shame. They didn't just leave the world. They left in shame and pain. These were not only overpowered and overwhelmed by the leaders of these enemies, but were also sent to hell by the brave warriors of Islam. And then Allama gives an account of the Battle of Badr, and it says it is not only a war between two parties. It is not only a war between two parties fighting each other. It is a war between faith and power. One side there was faith, and we know in one of the battles, Rasulullah even called Amir al-Mu'mineen Kulle Iman. It's a battle of faith against Kulle Kufr. That was that particular battle, but generally the battle was of power. All these Quraysh were fighting that they may lose power. And when we see Muawiyah, we see Yazid, this is the same thing, that they all wanted power over people. So he says that although there were some amongst these Muslims who were even scared at that time, in the Battle of Badr, they were scared. And in fact, they used to come to Rasulullah and say, let's not do this. They are fully armed. There are 1,000 people who are fully armed. They are all saddled because they were all on horses or camels. And we have nothing. We don't have arms. We don't have even animals to ride upon. How are we going to fight them? They are such a powerful army. And we are a few, because in Badr we know there were only 313 people, and there were only two animals that they rode on with a couple of swords. So they used to come to Rasulullah and tell him, let's leave this, let's walk away from here. We are going to be annihilated. And we see that the brave warriors in Badr fought against this very well-equipped army, the so-called powerful army, and just two people, Hamza bin Abdul Muttalib and Ali ibn Abi Talib salawatullahi wa salam alayk, were enough to give them a deathly blow. And what they did was, first, they stood firm, and second, they finished Utba and his son Walid. Who was Utba? Utba was the father of Hind, Abu Sufyan's wife, that is the nanabapa of Muawiyah. And Walid was his mama, his maternal uncle. So they finished these two, who were the very strong pillars of the opposition and the enemies of Islam. And they finished these two, and they sent them to hell in the very first moments of the beginning of the war. When we look at this, that these two fatalities had such an impact on the enemies, that even Hind, the wife of Abu Sufyan, mother of Muawiyah, who lived in power, who lived with drunkenness of power and pomp and whatever we say, if that these powerful people live with, and she swore at that time that this is a blow to me that I cannot digest, and therefore I want to chew the liver of Ali or Hamza. And we see that she finally did it in the next battle, which was Uhud, when she went to the battlefield, got Hamza killed and got Hamza's liver and chewed it. And this is what Amir al-Mu'mineen writes to Muawiyah and reminds him. And this is a sermon in Nahjul Balagha when he says, "The sword with which I finished off your maternal grandfather," that is Utba, Muawiyah's grandfather. This is a letter that he wrote to Muawiyah. "And your maternal uncle," that is Walid bin Utba, "and your brother Hanzala," which was the son of Abu Sufyan, the same sword is with me, and I still possess the same strength. That if I want to, Amir al-Mu'mineen is saying, if I want to, I can finish you as well the way I finished all those enemies before you, who are from your own lineage. And here we see that initially, Allama is now taking us to the other side of the battle. And he says, initially, Abu Sufyan was on a journey, which was a business trip towards Sham, and was passing near Makkah, near Medina. And it is at that time he had 40 people with him, and they were not armed. They were going on a trade mission. So the Muslims wanted to attack them, but Allah did not want that to happen. Allah wanted that if they did that, then the message would have been diluted, and he did not want that. And Allama is telling us that Allah wanted them to fight with their faith, despite not being equipped at that time. And he refers to Surah Anfal, Surah number 8, in which Allah says he has ordained victory when he says, وَإِذْ يَعِدُكُمُ اللَّهُ إِحْدَى الطَّائِفَتَيْنِ أَنَّهَا لَكُمْ وَتَوَدُّونَ أَنْ غَيْرَ ذَاتِ الشَّوْكَةِ تَكُونُ لَكُمْ وَيُرِيدُ اللَّهُ أَنْ يُحِكَّ الْحَقَّ بِكَلِمَاتِهِ وَيَقْطَعَ دَابِرَ الْكَافِرِينَ. And when Allah promised Rasulullah, Allah promised you one of the two parties that it shall be yours, and you love the one not armed should be yours. The Muslims wanted that because they are not armed, they can overpower them better. But Allah says, but Allah desired to manifest the truth of what was true by His words, and to cut off the root of unbelievers. So sometimes when we see that there is a tougher way, a harder way of doing things, it is because Allah wants to manifest the truth, that however difficult it was for Rasulullah and the Ahlul-bayt, they still gave the message of truth in a manner of truth as well, not by any other ways, though this was an option available. Yet Rasulullah did not allow the Muslims to attack Abu Sufyan's party, which was going towards Sham for his trade mission. Ayatullah Mehdi Puya says that these verses, that is Surah Anfal's verses, refer to two alternatives that were mentioned. And he says, the merchandise of the caravan, either they go and attack the merchandise of the caravan or face the Meccan army in self-defense. Because until then, Abu Sufyan had not attacked. If Rasulullah and Muslims would have attacked, it would have been seen that they were the aggressors. But here, when Abu Sufyan came with 1,000 armed people to fight Rasulullah, Rasulullah stood up in defense of Islam, in defense of the Muslims. And therefore, we see, Allama Nasir Makarim says, that we see that the Badris, those Ashab al-Badr, as we say, are those who are the party of the truth, and they were bestowed with a unique honor. There are many ahadith by Rasulullah praising the Ashab of Badr because they had gone without anything, only faith was the only thing. And that is why there is a lot of honor that they were given, which is very unique to them. And as Allah promised that there is going to be divine punishment, the enemies were of Islam were sent to hell, they were sent to perdition for annihilation, never to be mentioned in good ever again. And this happened in a very short time, 15 years. Within 15 years of whatever they did to Rasulullah, they already started seeing defeat for themselves. And these were saved into divine punishment, not only in the barzakh, because there are events we see in, after the war, that there is one particular war in which Rasulullah goes to the dead bodies of the enemies and talks to them and says, did you get your promise? I did get my promise. Meaning Rasulullah is telling those people that did you see what happened to you and can you now feel the fire that you are in? In fact, at that time, one of those very so-called close companions also questioned Rasulullah, are you talking to dead bodies now? It's the same person who probably at one time even said that I had already had doubts about this messenger, but today my doubts were doubled. He says, are you talking to dead bodies? And Rasulullah says, they can hear me better than what you can. Now, there are many interpretations to this which we need not go into at this time. However, Allama says that Allah has promised their final punishment on the day of Qiyamah, which is also very near. So this is one part of the discussion of the ayah of number 11 of Surah Muzzammil, in which Allah is saying, leave me and the enemies of the messenger, I will work with them myself because this is my message, and therefore fighting my message is as my messenger is as good as fighting my message, and therefore it is fighting me, and I will take care of it. Inshallah, the second one is about the second part of this ayah is talking about the pride and arrogance of the affluent of that time, which will be inshallah next time. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the tawfiq to be able to understand and comprehend the teachings of the Quran the way the Ahlul-bayt alayhimus salam have taught us and implement them in our lives. Ameen ya rabbal alameen wa sallallahu ala muhammadin wa alihi tawhirin.